Great to be here and great to see a lot of friends that I haven't seen in a long time, and great energy at this meeting. So we're moving from the mitral valve to the tricuspid valve. And tricuspid valve, you know, we've talked about it this morning. We talked about it last night a little bit in the case presentations. It's been called a forgotten valve by some, unnecessary valve by others. I remember one of my teachers, an adult cardiac surgeon, who would say, you never need to, you don't worry about the tricuspid valve, you can take it out. And in fact, a recent paper published, I think, last month, was showing that decent results in endocarditis, tricuspid valve endocarditis, where you basically cut out the valve and leave nothing behind. That's not something that's very useful in the pediatric arena, for sure, because we are often dealing with, you know, high PVR and a lot of other malformations. But we'll focus here on the Epstein's disease, which obviously is a specific congenital focus problem, and tricuspid valve dysplasia. Epstein's anomaly, I think everybody in this room is very familiar with the Epstein's, with the displaced septal leaflet that can be, you know, displaced all the way into the RVOT with attachments that can go all the way up to the pulmonary valve. You can have a PFO or not, AST or not, and various degrees of tricuspid regurgitation. But usually, I think it's underestimated on the preoperative echo, because the regurg occurs typically in the depth of the ventricle, where normally the normal annular plane would be here. And so I really think that it is often underestimated when we get those echoes. There's the typical sail-like anterior leaflet. Obviously a dilation of the true tricuspid annulus. Historically, the indications to operate cyanosis right heart failure, I would say, with the advent of the cone procedure and better results with the cone procedure, that we would argue, and it is a matter of debate, I would grant you this, but we would argue to operate electively on an Epstein's patient if there's any signs of symptoms of any kind. Just as a footnote, what happens if you, in a child, replace the tricuspid valve with a tissue valve? This is what happens. It's really a very ugly calcification. Stenosis occurs very quickly. And in the era before the valve-in-valve therapies, this was a big, big problem. So we don't do that. Historically, it's interesting to go back to the sort of how these repairs were done for Epstein's, because the cone procedure, which is sort of the current standard, is based mostly, not so much Danielson repair, but the Carpentier repair. But the Danielson from the Mayo Clinic had introduced a sort of a vertical plication of the dilated annulus without really touching the valve. And as a consequence of this repair, there was a lot of tricuspid regurgitation that was left behind, typically. Carpentier then took that, basically introduced a step of cutting into the leaflet. That was him, not the Silva, who introduced the cone procedure, and had a rotation detaching the anterior sail-like leaflet, which is really the one leaflet that you have that you can work with, and detaching that and then rotating it clockwise, as you see here, with or without a ring, depending if you're operating on an adult or not, and with a reduction of the annulus just anterior to the coronary sinus. So that was the Carpentier approach, but you notice that here, in the septal region, nothing was done, and every patient, and I started my career before the cone was developed, and we really expected to see regurgitation in septal leaflet, and there was really a fair amount of regurgitation, at least moderate, very often. And so that was not a perfect repair. And then comes along the cone procedure that was really a further advance of the Carpentier repair by Dr. De Silva in Brazil, who basically mobilized the entire valve. And I'll show you a little bit more in detail about how we do this particular procedure. So here we go. This is an important, maybe for cardiologists who don't see this very often. This is a surgeon's view of the tricuspid valve. You know, patient on bypass, you've opened the right atrium. And normally, the tricuspid, this is a coronary sinus, PFO. Normally, the tricuspid valve should be anchored at this level here. This would be the true annulus. Instead, what you see is anterior leaflet is anchored at the normal level, but everything else is displaced, and this is atrialized portion of the of the ventricle, which we will be placating in the future. This is smooth and non-trabeculating trabeculated muscle. And so this is the area that you would attack. Now, the danger here is that there are coronaries running. It's very thin muscle, much thinner than a normal RV. We know Epstein's is a right ventricular disease. And you can see it because the RV muscle is not normal in this disease when you actually look at it. So the first step is to take down the anterior leaflet again, clockwise, kind of like the Carpentier procedure. And then this is Epstein's is also, in addition to being RV disease, is failure of delamination of the valve. So you basically delaminate the valve and you cut all those secondary chordae that are attached. Now, you can see here the similarities with mitral valve surgery that David just explained. All the secondary chordae are cut. Only the free edge chordae are kept. And that has absolute very, very important. Otherwise, you have a tethering effect. And if you leave just one secondary chordae behind, your repair is really not going to work. And then here again, this is the atrialized portion that you will placate. If you don't have enough opening, you can create a little bit more openings here by creating neocordae, so to speak, but that's not done very commonly. This is a nice interoptive picture where you can see how thin this valve is, and it's been detached here from the annulus, and it becomes sort of, as you're working your way through, you develop more and more valve tissue that you later can use after you create the cone. And this is further. And this is really, I have to say, a very artistic operation. This is not something that you can follow cookbook-wise. But you have the anterior leaflet here, posterior leaflet here, septal leaflet here. You see that this septal leaflet has been, all these leaflets really were fused to the endocardium, the posterior and the septal leaflet, and those were delaminated, detached from the endocardium. Anterior leaflet was sail-like, but was detached from the annulus. And you have to be creative here and create those suture lines to put it together. Eventually, what we will do is this suture line will come to this suture line here, creating, if you can imagine, a complete cone. This is what I was just explaining. So you would basically put those together, creating a cone. And and now here you have the cone that's been done. You're doing the placation in the atrialized portion. Line here is supposed to show the right coronary. That's something that we constantly keep in mind. Again, placation of the annulus above the coronary sinus, which is a good marker. AV node is going to be here. Now these are Mayo pictures, so they call this vein of Danielson because Dr. Danielson was there. I don't know that it's a real anatomic name for it, but you might as well call it that. You do have often a vein in the area of the AV node, and so we try to be careful. And you can implant you can see the cone has been re-implanted in a true annulus here, and you can go either above the AV node or below. I typically go below, but this picture shows it above. This is final view. You can see that this is testing with saline, and you can see the leaflets that have been. This is the suture line on the true annulus, this is a cartoon showing what you have. We've done 16 personal series of 16 patients, 6 adult and 10 pediatrics. So 1 pacemaker implantation, 2 reoperation, 1 re-repair, and 1 replacement. Both of them in 1 kid and 1 adult. So I think it's a good operation, but it's not a simple operation. Moving on to the second sort of topic is tricuspid valve dysplasia. Now there's not much to read on tricuspid valve dysplasia, and when you do a PubMed search, mostly it's mentioned in the context of fetal diagnosis. I don't know if the fetal cardiologists want to call Epstein's. I don't know if Lindsay is here or somebody who can explain that to me, but it's called a lot tricuspid valve dysplasia, and you see it in dogs and horses, and I had no idea that that was the case, but that's what you have. It is very little sort of surgical literature on how to deal with tricuspid valve dysplasia, yet we actually see it not an unreasonable amount, and it's difficult to manage. I'm much rather simpler to deal with Epstein's than tricuspid valve dysplasia. I'm curious what my other core surgeons think about that. but they have thickened chordae, they have some apical displacement. I recently had a patient where the anterior leaflet was displaced at least an inch or more down into the RV. I'd never seen that before. And then they often have a mixed TS and TR. As I mentioned, more difficult to manage surgically. This is where you actually use all the mitral repair techniques. You move them to the tricuspid valve, and you do leaflet augmentation, rotationoplasty. You put annular plication, rings, and so forth. Same techniques that you use in the mitral valve for the tricuspid valve, but it's really on a case-by-case basis. And when all else fails in a small child, I'm sorry, Rick, I don't mean to steal your thunder, but there's a way to create a tricuspid valve replacement with a core matrix tube. We discussed that last night. For those who were here at the case presentations, this is the first paper on this in adults. But basically, it's a tube that you implant that's made out of core matrix, which is tissue engineered patch that is implanted into the tricuspid annulus, and then at the papillary muscle tips, as you can see here, this is the actual tube, and this is the testing of it. This is what an echo is supposed to look like if it looks well done. This is Rick's paper from Michigan on that, and they have used it for the mitral. This is Frank Scholl's paper. Also a description, and this is an animal study, but you can see here the attachment to the papillary muscles, and this is a testing from the atrial portion side of things, where you inject saline, and you can see out of a tube, you end up having three almost equal size leaflets, if you will. So it actually is really not a bad option for some of the patients that you cannot repair and they're too young to have a prosthesis placed. This is another animal study, well-healed valve. You can see it almost looks like a valve. This started off as a core matrix tube, so it's really quite impressive. And this is, again, sheep here at 7 months. You can see what it looks like with the attachments here to the papillary muscles. We've done two patients with the core matrix cylinder or tube. I don't want to go into too much detail. We can discuss later if you want. A 9-year-old, they're all, you know, he had two tricuspid valve repairs in the past, had Fontan-like physiology, massive TR, and had a tube replacement at the time. Had trace TR, trace TS on the post-op TEE. Now 5 years post-op, Dr. Kiblawi gave me the, and Susan gave me the, an up-to-date, you know, information on how he's doing. He has moderate TR and TS, but he's clinically extremely well. And so at this point, the decision is to continue to watch him. So he got 5 years out of this tube, which I think is not bad, considering the options that we have, right? I mean, what options do you have in a 5-year-old or 4-year-old with a tricuspid valve? And then we have this 4-year-old. That was a patient that Aaron presented last night with multiple procedures, repair, then core matrix tube. Then ballooning twice, and then tricuspid valve replacement with EPIC, and then Melody valve and the EPIC valve, and most recently doing okay, but with a lot of procedures. So, you know, those are complicated patients. So in conclusion, tricuspid valve repairs are variable. Epsinoid and tricuspid valve dysplasia are more difficult to deal with than Epstein's, and you have to, as with all valves, you have to carefully analyze the anatomy and pre-op imaging. Thank you very much for your attention.